My name is Randy Mandell. I am not an economist, I'm an activist, but I feel pretty comfortable with the material that I'm presenting, and I'm working with two economists who I actually have checked my material with, so I do feel pretty comfortable. So the presentation tonight is on climate change, building a green economy with modern monetary theory, which may sound like a little bit of a dull topic, but I think you're going to be surprised because this may be one of the most powerful tools we could have to actually do a World War II mobilization and rapidly build a green economy. In fact, I think it's probably the only way. Because I get tongue-tied by saying modern monetary theory, I will just refer to it as MMT. Now, modern money simply reflects, and we'll talk about this, that the US came off the gold standard in 1971, which creates a whole set of new policy options. So modern simply reflects post-1971. I actually like, as I get older, that I can refer back to the 1970s as something that's modern. But what this is actually gonna let us do is create a full employment economy. Everybody can have a job with a living wage and health benefits, rapidly build a green economy, also build green affordable housing, and go a long way to fix our education system, our pensions, so much of our community, and it's actually for free, which may sound a little surprising. It's an extremely powerful tool that if we are aware of, we should put to use. A couple words about the climate, because it's an emergency that we build a large-scale green economy. One on the left is referring to carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and everybody knows that the reason we're having global warming is there's an increase in greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. Methane is one, carbon dioxide is the one we mostly talk about. And in pre-industrial times, CO2 was at 280 parts per million. Science tells us that if we get to 350, more heat will be trapped than will reflect back. So at 350 parts per million, the planet will just continue to warm. So it's critical we never go above 350 parts per million. We're at 400. And that is actually an emergency. Time is very tight to get back to 350, or our species faces a serious problem of survival. It's technically possible to get back to 350 by the end of the century. What we had to do, and this slide is several years old, what we should have done was if we can reduce emissions 6% a year internationally, every year until we're off fossil fuels and plant a trillion trees for carbon capture, we would have gotten back to 350 by the year 2100, which may still be in time to avoid the worst of what's coming. We didn't do that. And at this point, we're gonna have to decrease by about 8 to 10% a year internationally, not just in the United States, but internationally. And if we wait much longer, it gets to be 15%, which is about the upper limits of our technology. My understanding is we have about 4 years to be well on our way. Even if our targets are to be off fossil fuels in 2030, when you're phasing off 6, 8, 10% a year, you can't wait to 2030 to start. You had to start actually several years ago, but there's still technically time if we really got going now. This slide just points out if we let the CO2 get a little higher and do everything that we're going to talk about, we would get there by the year 2300. That's not a discussion we want to have. So we need a rapid mobilization, getting going in the next couple years, or we're not gonna make it. There was this thing in Paris where the countries agreed that we didn't wanna go above 2 degrees elevation. We're about at 0.8 to 1 now, and there's enough already in the pipeline that no matter what we do, we'll get to 1.5. And we're gonna get to 2. The question is, can we come back down before the damage becomes absolutely catastrophic? What people said in Paris is many countries made agreed to voluntary actions. You know, voluntary. And if everything they did, they said they did, we'd probably level off about 3.7 degrees. So that's not what people were advertising. And the call is that we really have to get serious. And what we need is not only to abruptly come off fossil fuels, but rapidly build a green economy. And in fact, the faster you can build a green economy, probably the easier it is to get off fossil fuels. So what we need to do, of course, is to go from dirty fuels to clean fuels. And what if in the process we can also create full employment, build a green infrastructure, affordable green housing, help healthcare, education, and retirement all at the same time, and again, have it be for free? A lot of advantages, and pretty easy to see how you can put a coalition together, because everybody wants to save the environment, and lots of people need these things as well. And to be able to do them together through the same program is a pretty powerful thing. The question, of course, is how are you going to pay for this? Now, the MMT people will tell you it's for free, and I'll explain why that is. But conventional thinking is we can't afford it. Certainly Wall Street and the financial interests are not going to finance this. And the government, we're told, is broke. We have a huge deficit. In fact, we're told we have to cut social spending to use money to pay back the debt, and we have to privatize. So clearly that model says there's no way we can pay for this. Given the urgency of climate crisis and all the social programs, when people say something with this confidence and this importance, the question should always be, well, is that true? You know, is it true that we can't afford this? Because the MMT people said we can afford it very easily. The critical thing to note is in 1971, we came off the gold standard. The financial system between World War II and 1971, and I'm going to be brief on this part, is the world's currencies were pegged to the dollar, and the dollar was on a gold standard. Simply stated, the ratio of dollars to gold was fixed. If you wanted to print more dollars, you had to acquire more gold, which put limits on how much dollars you can acquire. In 1971, we came off the gold standard. Why? Well, we were already off it. During the Korean War, the US printed dollars to help pay for military spending without acquiring any gold, so we actually had more dollars than gold. And realized we had spent dollars abroad paying for military bases and buying up important assets like factories and other companies, and part of the reason they let us do that is they knew they can turn those dollars back in for gold later. Then with the Vietnam War, more dollars were spent to pay for the war and social programs, and it was clear there was not enough gold backing, and there was some question of a run on the gold, so Nixon said, we're no longer going to convert the dollar into gold, and all those people abroad who accepted our dollars to build bases and buy up their factories, we're not going to give any gold after all. We kind of changed our mind. That didn't go over very well and leads to another very important story, but it's not tonight's story. But remember, most of the key economic books and all the ideas that have been drilled into us were written before 1971, when we were on the gold standard. Almost everything we know, and it's so drilled it seems so obvious, was based on the time we were on the gold standard. We're not on it now, and that actually is a big change. And there's very little written about the new economy post-1971. And probably the best is works by L. Randall Ray called Modern Money. And there's a series of people in that group who've done a number of important talks and written a number of books. But the point is simply this. We're not on the gold standard. What does that mean? What does that change? And what does it allow us to do? What we have now is fiat money. And that simply means the following. Your dollars are not backed by gold or anything else. The reason they're important to you is you need some of them at the end of the year to pay your taxes and fees, so you're required to hold some of your wealth in dollars. But the government can print them. They're not dependent on any gold standard. And in fact, if the government who spends the money also prints the money, and the money's not on a gold standard, that's called sovereign money. And sovereign money gives governments enormous policy possibilities that are so essential in dealing with climate change. Now, I've given talks on this many times, and what's about to happen is always a very difficult time. So I just want to remind all of us who have children to think back to the time when we had to explain to our young children where babies came from. My son wanted to know in kindergarten, and it's supposed to be a difficult conversation. It was actually pretty easy. But when we tell our children where babies come from, there's three responses no parent ever gets. One, yeah, that's basically what I assumed. Two, no child has the foresight to say that seems too good to be true. And no child kind of rolls their eyes and tells their friends, you know, my parents are conspiracy theorists. So now we come to the more awkward question, where does money come from? Because that's going to be a big part of our story. Where does money come from? And it's not what you think. John Kenneth Galbraith pointed out the process by which money is created is so simple that the mind is repelled by it. So let me start with this point that money exists as coins, it exists as dollars, and it exists electronically, money that's on a keyboard. Most modern money is simply numbers on a keyboard. That's the vast majority of money is electronic. Let's say I want to go to a university bookstore, a few blocks from here, where I spend a great deal of time and want to buy some books. Two topics that interest me are economics and the environment. So Modern Money and Naomi Klein's important book, which I hope everybody read, are two really important books. So I grab those two books and I bring it up to the counter and I put it down and I show my debit card. I hit a few numbers and money leaves my account. It goes into the account of the university bookstore and they seem perfectly happy for me to take those books home. Now there's more money in the university bookstore's bank account, but that came from my account and everybody knows how that works. But let's say I want to make a bigger purchase and I want to buy a Leaf. They now get over 200 miles to a charge, and that's exactly what we're thinking about. But that's a $30,000 car. You just don't go there with a debit card. So I go to my bank and ask for a loan, or my credit union, and I sign a contract, I pay back with interest, they put the money in my account, I go to the Nissan dealership, we have a negotiation, I probably overpay, I transfer the money, and I bring the car home. They now have $30,000 in the account they didn't have before. Where did it come from? My account. How did I get into my account? The bank put it there, or the credit union. Where was it before then? And most people think the bank or credit union takes money that people have deposited and loans it to me. And that's not true. Where the money came from is they just entered into my computer account and just put the $30,000 there and created the money out of thin air. It didn't exist before. Did everybody know that? This is from the Bank of England. Whenever a bank makes a loan, it simultaneously creates a matching deposit in the borrower's bank account, thereby creating new money. Let's put it different from the International Review of Financial Analysis. Each individual bank creates money out of nothing when it extends what is called a bank loan. The bank does not loan any existing money, but instead creates new money. The money supply is created as fairy dust produced by the banks out of thin air. The implications are far-reaching. And one implication is austerity has always been a lie. When they tell us there isn't money for social spending, for healthcare, for education, for green economy, that's simply not true. The money could always be created. Now the point, of course, is the goods and services that are needed. And what MMT is going to show is how we produce the money actually can create those goods and services. I'll come to there. But for now, when people say there's no money for, the fact of the matter is the money could be created. It's a bank business decision based on profitability and their control model not to produce that money, but they could if they had wanted to. So banks are for profit and they want to maintain their control. They're probably not going to be interested in changing their minds. But if the banks can create money on their keyboards, why can't governments? And the fact is they can. And the fact is they do and have done so for large money when it's been in the interest of the 1%. It's also important that some of the government spending, they actually borrow money from banks. Now what happens is the banks create the money out of nowhere on their computers, loan it to the government, who then spends it, and then has to repay it back to the bank with money with interest. Now that's money the government created completely on their own in the first place, which raises some important questions. Anything the government is borrowing from financial markets, it could have created itself. And what it's doing is borrowing it and then repaying it a larger sum back with interest. And if we get behind in those payments, we have to start slashing social spending in order to pay those payments. And of course, then there's no money for green economy. But repeat, the government could have put that money on their computer just the same as the banks did. And there's another difference, and this is the key to MMT. When the bank creates a loan, it's creating debt that must be paid back with compounding interest. When the government creates the money, let's say it wants to build a solar panel, and let's say it's $1 billion. So the banks could make that money, give it to the government, and then they can pay for the solar panels and pay it back with interest. But the government could simply put the money in their own keyboards, create a grant, and pay for the building of those solar panels. That money is technically a debt. The dollars in your pocket are technically a debt, but they never have to be paid back. So technically the government could create the money on their keyboard, and not only don't they have to pay it back to the banks with interest, it doesn't have to be paid back at all. So here's the key point of MMT. If you have unemployed people and you create new money on a bank computer and they're put back to work doing a socially useful thing like building housing, providing health care, education, building infrastructure, or building green economy, the goods and services built balances the dollars. You print the dollars for free. They don't have to be repaid back. And society is much, much better off. And again, it doesn't cost anything. No taxes have to be raised. No deficit spending that has to be paid back. As long as you have unemployed people and a productive capacity to put them to do something useful, what they create balances the money. There's no inflation. Everyone's much better off, except the banks, who lose a profitable business. But if you wanted to build a green economy extremely quickly and make people like that program because you're going to get rid of unemployment and build housing and fix pensions, it's actually quite doable. When he was testifying to Congress, Greenspan, about Social Security, and people were saying Social Security is about to run out of money, he said, well, that's funny. This is a quote. A government cannot become insolvent with respect to obligations in its own currency. A fiat money system like the one we have today can produce such claims without limit. You're not going to run out of money. But he goes on to point out that you can give retirees more money, but if there's no goods and services, what good does it do them? But as the MMT point out, since the Great Recession and the high employment rate, there's about $5 to $6 trillion of output we haven't had. If we had paid money to put people to work to make that output, you're in a position to offer much better benefits than we have now for retirees and fix unemployment. It's a tool that we have. So in the old days, we were on a gold standard. Money was balanced by gold. Now what you can do is create new money on a keyboard, debt-free, and as long as people are put to work to make goods and services that balance that money, just like gold would have, it's non-inflationary, you don't have to raise taxes, and you can build these output. It just requires unemployed people, productive capabilities, and a socially useful need. The money is printed on a government keyboard, people are put to work, the output is there, and everything balances. Now, fortunately, that system would be sort of democratic socialism. And fortunately, we have capitalism, so we don't have to suffer that kind of a problem. What we do is we fortunately get to borrow money from the banks, pay it back with interest, getting in trouble, cutting social spending, having to take on more debt, getting more into trouble, and kind of going into an austerity cycle, which clearly works so much better than the MMT model could ever work. And you can quickly see how great it is for people and the environment. John Maynard Keynes basically said, anything we can actually do, we can afford. Meaning, we have unemployed people, there's a useful task that's going to produce some output, we could print the money, have them do it, it all balances out, we can afford to do it. Some arguments that you'll hear is we can't do it because government spending crowds out private spending. The argument goes back to the gold standard. Basically, if money is based on gold, if some gold is allocated towards government spending, then less gold is allocated for private spending. And in the old days, people can get together in coffee shops and have big debates whether government spending was better or social spending was better. But before you get too involved in the debate, just remember, the debate hasn't been relevant since Nixon was president. Now, the other thing you're going to hear is, well, there's a huge deficit, and we have a huge deficit. I'm not going to do it today, but it's worth asking how we came to have this deficit. Quite a few questions there. But the point is, out of the love of our children, we have to cut spending because we don't want to give our children this big deficit. Several things to say. MMT is independent of this deficit. You print the money on a computer, put people to work, make a goods and service, the money doesn't have to be repaid. That is irrelevant to this. Whether we're in surplus or deficit, it actually doesn't matter. You can still do MMT. As long as you have unemployed people, productive capability, and a social need, this is not relevant. Now, of course, what they're going to say very emotionally is, for the love of our children, we don't want to leave them this deficit, which raises the question why the government was borrowing from the banks in the first place. But if we're worried about our children and we pay back this so-called debt and don't invest in green economy, You kind of see where that's going. Is it fair to, you know, give people jobs? First of all, no deficit, no increase in taxes. Everybody without a job suddenly gets a job with a, be able to afford a standard of living. Well, what about me if I, you know, already have a job? Well, what happens is all these people with a job now have spendable money and health insurances, which means if you're a business or you're a clinic or whatever, you know, most businesses don't close the doors and worry, what if we get more customers? I mean, it tends to work well for everybody. Plus, we don't have to spend as much money on unemployment, welfare, incarceration, and if we're gonna go away from austerity, we don't have to militarize the police anymore. It's a different model of production. These are government grants that can go to the communities to build green economy and infrastructure. So these can be workers-run cooperatives. They can be community-owned run cooperatives. They could be tribal enterprises, which allows more humanitarian work situations. It's also good for unions. It's key to make sure that these jobs don't replace unions and the people in these programs can unionize. But when you eliminate unemployment and the fear of unemployment, it puts unions in a better position to make better demands because the big fear of their workers of being destitute has been taken away. That's a big advantage of a full employment economy. It actually puts upward pressure on wages of unions. It also means from business perspective, all those unemployed are now gonna have current work skills, which makes them more hireable if business wants to hire them later. So it's a good jobs training program for business as well, right? This is a friend of mine who's an economist who wrote a good article in Counterpunch. The implications of a realistic understanding of modern money, I think, are far more radical than imagined. Government borrowing is an unnecessary subsidy to private investors, which exposes austerity as a fraud that we need to think very carefully about, because we shouldn't be playing that game anymore. Two, there's no rationale for private banks charging interest on loans. They create it for free. There is no reason for these high interest rates. And if you're struggling with a mortgage or credit card debts or car debts or student loan debts, you know, it is something to think about. And if you're worried about how we'll ever finance a World War II level buildup of the economy, again, there's another tool out there. It's a favorite slide of mine. If you can't read it, the bear is pulled off his muzzle and turns to the other bear and says, well, hey, these things snap right off. So I'm going to make a summary of what I talked about now and move in a slightly different direction. So MNT is a for-free program that allows us to wipe out unemployment, build a green economy, rebuild infrastructure, fix several other things, build, I think, a big coalition, and in doing so, maybe convince people we can still be the same country again, and really address climate change. Before I move on, I want to ask the audience three questions about MMT. How many of you are thinking, yeah, that's just what I thought it was going to be? How many of you are thinking, this seems too good to be true? I remember holding my son the day he was born and watched him grow up to be a fine young man, and every day seemed too good to be true. But it was, and this actually is true. It's not in place, but it can be true. I'm not gonna ask, because I'm afraid, but I'm hoping you're not thinking that I'm a conspiracy theorist. And in fact, I'll show you that this is starting to get into mainstream political thinking, and it just needs a push. So I wanna go back and just look very briefly at 45 years of what we've gone through in what's called a financialized economy. I usually spend about an hour and a half what I'm just going to do in a couple slides, so I'm going to be extremely brief. I think everybody has seen this slide, and Richard Wolff does a great job talking about it. This comes from Robert Reich, but it points out that it used to be that when workers produced more, they got paid more. So they could buy what they were producing, and the economy worked out well, and people maintained reasonable standards of living. The way this slide is set up, it makes it look like this happened under Reagan, but actually, this starts actually in 1971 under Nixon, and it continues under Carter, but Reagan really accelerates it. But what you see is productivity goes flying off the chart, and working wages are just crushed. Now, that's not a market decision. That was a policy decision that could have gone in different directions and still can. It comes down to crushing unions, outsourcing, automation, which is going to replace about half of the jobs. And the technology used for automation and outsourcing were created by taxpayers under Pentagon systems and then privatized and used against us. You know, if we had gotten the benefits of those investments, we'd look in a very different world. In fact, if we simply kept the proceeds of automation, we can be down to a 20-hour work week and even less. which if it gets a full employment and pulled together is worth thinking about. Remember, with a lower work week, there's less stress, there's more time to enjoy life, more spiritual things to do, and less need for this ridiculous consumption, which is not only not good for us, it's not good for the environment. There are a number of ways to bring this line back. As I said, full employment, better wages, taxes on the rich, sharing automation. But this produces two problems. For working people, you know, there's not the means to maintain their lifestyles. But for corporations who made it as a policy to crush wages, they now have all this productivity and they can't sell it. So they made a conscious decision to substitute wages for debt. And this is the period where credit cards come on. People aren't going to be paid enough, but they can borrow the money, paying interest to the banks, to buy the stuff they made because the corporations need them to buy the stuff. They just don't want to pay them the wages. And the banks are happy to make interest on the credit cards. And we're told this game can go on indefinitely. I mean, just that's kind of obvious, right? You can max out credit cards for only so long. The next step in the game is actually the housing situation. Housing prices were driven up by a lot of illegal or at least immoral activities, and people were told their house price will go up indefinitely. They can take money out of the house and use it for spending. Why? Wages weren't going up, credit cards were maxed out, so your house becomes a new credit card. In fact, Alan Greenspan said that loading workers with debt is a good thing. It'll make them more insecure about losing their job and missing a mortgage payment, so they'll take less wages. So they use debt to replace wages, and then debt to lower wages, making you more dependent on debt. And they said, no one could foresee how this can fall apart. Like, you'd have to be a genius to see how this can go wrong. Which tells you something about mainstream economists. And remember, they're the ones who tell you MMT can't work. The people who said this could never go wrong are the same people that say MMT can't work. That doesn't prove anything, but I would maybe be a little skeptical about their claims. Because surprise, surprise, oh, I forgot, there's the student loans, didn't help. 2008 came and maybe it wasn't as perfect a system as they imagined. Now comes time for the bailout. And this is a real important moment. What the MMT people were saying is this. Most of the financial debt was all illegal debt anyway, or basically criminal debt. Let it go and use MMT to rebuild the real economy. I mean, we could do that, right? The bailout was $13 trillion. Some of that is just giving the money, some of that is buying bad assets, namely their debt products, remember how that came to be, and some of it is loaning the banks money at about 0% to either loan it back to the government at higher interest or going abroad and buying financial instruments and manipulating their economy to rip them off. But $13 trillion. With the MMT people, and the banks were saying, if you don't do this, we'll bring the economy down. We'll cut off the supply of credit. You'll never get money. You'll be destitute. And the MMT people are saying, no, actually, this is a good thing. We don't want your austerity money. Actually, let's wipe you out, and let's use the money to build green economy, full employment economy, and we'll use MMT to go in a very different direction, including building up green economy, because we were almost out of time. Now, is it possible the government didn't understand MMT was an option, and we were stuck with the bank threats? Because the bank threat was, we'll cut off the money. And the MMTers were saying, but that's not possible. We can create the money for much better purposes, debt-free. Did the government not know that? Well, that's a hard argument to actually take seriously, and that's for the following reason. $13 trillion was the bailout. Ben Bernanke was on 60 Minutes, and they asked him, that's a lot of money. Is that tax money? And he said, it's not tax money. Well, then where did it come from? I mean, money doesn't grow on trees. And then he explained it. He said, the big banks have accounts at the Fed, just like you have accounts at your bank or credit union. And, exact words, we simply use the computer to mark up the size of the account they had with the Fed. They use MMT to bail out the banks. Take a minute and let that sink in. Now, the possibility of using MMT, of course, still exists, but we never, ever had to go down that road. My wife found this, I absolutely love it. It says, why do we allow private companies to create money out of nothing, and then we borrow that money from them and pay interest on it when the money could be created free of debt and for the public interest? I guess if there's a question you want to remember, that's that. Now remember, when they bailed the banks out, not only did they bail them out, They didn't require them to be regulated. They didn't break them up. And they didn't say to the banks, we'll bail you out, I guess, but at a minimum, write off the student debt, write down the credit card debt, write down the mortgage debt. I mean, you basically stole it in the first place. If we're going to bail you out, write all this down. And the banks, well, we'll cut off the money supply. Okay, we have no choice. It's really important to understand that was never true. They also left in debts, the government debts and the municipal debts, and the biggest debt of all, though no one describes it, and that is the green economy debt, which is going to come due. But by leaving the government debts in place and leaving the municipal debts in place, it forced communities to make cuts, privatize, and cut corners. And that led to, among other things, what you saw in Flint, Michigan, where a whole community of children were poisoned because they were diverting water because of a, quote, debt issue. It's not only tragic, but her science speaks a lot more than just the children of Flint, Michigan. But this is intolerable. We were out of money. I want to talk briefly about the TPP. This is something I usually spend an hour on, too. I'm going to do it in one slide. The United States is imposing this austerity model based on a lie on the rest of the world. And we've done it to the so-called third world. We're doing it in Europe. You can see it in Greece. And they're now trying to extend it to other parts of the world. A number of countries have formed a new economic group. It's called the BRICS, and it was started by Brazil, Russia, India, and China. Others have joined, and they're trying to create an economy that's not subjected to this financial manipulation and austerity. And the U.S. doesn't want this to be successful. The BRICS are encouraging other countries to join, and we want countries to stay in the austerity sphere, if you will. So among other things, you're seeing militarization along the Russian border, where the threat of nuclear war is considered real at this point. In fact, we almost went to war with them a couple years earlier. And we're militarizing along the Chinese border, and that's also scary. But we also want to lock countries into this model, and that's a large part of what the TPP and the TTIP are all about, locking countries into this model. And remember, this is an austerity model. The TPP has rules that you can't regulate the banks, you can't regulate their dangerous products, you can't break them up. It creates parallel court system where if a government or court decision makes a rule or decision favorable people around a wide range of things, if a corporation evokes future lost profits, they go to a private court system that they staff, where the judges take turns being judges and then attorneys for the corporations. And since they want the corporations to choose those attorneys, they want the corporations to like them. They go back and forth. And they have made rulings that basically say you can't regulate to protect food safety, water safety, internet safety. And they've used these type of agreements to block countries from coming off fossil fuels and building green projects. There was a green workers project in Toronto that got in trouble. They shut down a solar panel program in India. And there are countries that have tried to come off coal and been hit with billion-dollar lawsuits in private courts where they're not going to win. So this is a scary thing, and this is based on imposing austerity on the rest of the world. And again, the big threat behind austerity is you have to conform or you will run out of money. It's based on a lie. And if we can work out in this country, we are going to open up a great deal of space for people's lives around the world. And remember, we had to come off fossil fuels 8% a year, 10% a year, every year around the entire world. TPP makes that impossible. I think it was Ben Beachy in Sierra Club, one of their high analysts, said, if TTP passes, we're not going to be able to win the war against the climate. And this is part of the fight against austerity, and it doesn't have to happen. So where we are is this system. MMT is, I think, a much better system. The question is, how do we get there? Another one of my favorite cartoons. If you can't see it, there's two scientists with a lot of very complicated math. Then there's a line in the middle that says, then a miracle happens. And his friend says, I think you should be a bit more explicit here in step two. So there are a handful of some really good economists, Stephanie Kelton, James Galbraith, L. Randall Ray, Michael Hudson, Warren Mosler, Bill Mitchell. And I honestly don't know how to pronounce Fadil's name as well as I'd like to, Fadil Kaboob, I believe, who are really good MMT economists. And they've done a lot of work on the options. And it turns out, one of their big people is Stephanie Kelton. She is an advisor to Bernie Sanders. In fact, Bernie Sanders took most of the MMT people as his key advisors during his campaign. He also put Stephanie Kelton on the Senate Bank Committee. there's a number of people who are recognizing, including Bernie Sanders, that MMT is a way forward for employment and green economy. And people who know some of these other Congress people who are aware of this say, yes, but we understand this, but we can't talk about it publicly. And until the public understands it, it's a hard conversation. Now, when I saw that Bernie Sanders was embracing this, I partly got excited and partially thought, okay, let's be realistic. This is a Jewish socialist. How far is this going to go? And he went very far. And I think if people had known what MMT was and that he favored it and his opponent didn't, to be tactful, it would have made, I think, a huge difference. But a lot is still going to go out of this. But Bernie never really talked about it, though clearly he's interested in it. And the question is why? And several possibilities occur to me. If I ask any one of you, here's a microphone, I want you to explain MMT in a 1 minute soundbite and not look really silly, have fun with that. It takes about an hour, and no one gets an hour. And even if you took the time and explained it to someone who didn't already know what it means, there's the friendly people in the corporate media who will spin that into something that'll make you seem crazy, which of course is what these guys do for a living. And of course, that also assumes they just don't ignore you. So until the public knows it and understands what this means in terms of everything I've talked about and that it's for free, it will cost the banks and it will mean higher wages for workers, which some corporations aren't going to like, which is something very painful that I feel bad about. But now I'm over it. It's good to be resilient. Now, encouraging is the people who do the MMT work, who are the big Bernie Sanders advisors, have started this institute. I spoke with them on the phone 2 days ago, and what they're doing is trying to help build a popular movement where people are going to understand this, where they're going to help people like me who are not economists to give these talks, to work on slideshows, to build information and where we can go what worked, what didn't work, and start connecting what people are doing around the country to get this message out. This is urgent. And what you need to do is the usual stuff. One, we need to get seeds in every city. So the churches, the unions, the environmental movement, the social justice movements, all need to get a sense of what this is about, and then in every city go to work, talking to legislatures, city council amendments, letters to the editor, and large workshops where people are trained to do these workshops and go out and just do them on their own. Build the word. It's not difficult, and when done, there's a big payoff. I would also say we should talk about the TPP at the same time for a couple reasons. One, the TPP will prevent this from happening. Two, we can, by talking to the TPP crowd and get them to know about MMT, that expands it. And since so many people are going to be interested in the jobs and the environmental, it's worth talking about the TPP. It's also important to know when you talk to the legislatures, they say TPP is really good for jobs, you know, kind of like NAFTA was. And you can say, well, I'm glad you're interested in jobs, actually, because there's a much better way to do it. In fact, one of the critiques we face with legislatures is, you guys are so negative. You know, you're so against the TPP. What are you for? And you can say, it's funny you should ask that. And I think it's important for building movements. And in the process, I think we can build the coalitions where our movements can overlap enough where I think we can really go forward. If you can't read it, the sign says, Flint, Michigan stands with Standing Rock. Water is life. No Dakota Access Pipeline. This MMT, I think, is a way to fix so many social programs and give us the World War II mobilization we desperately need. And we need to do it. Not just for this girl, though she's certainly worth it, but for all the children in the world and for the children that are going to follow. Because if we don't do this soon, we're in a world of trouble. Dear humanity, time is running out. The experts are basically saying the window is closing fast for society to respond to the worst impacts of a fast warming planet. Part of the problem, I think, is the climate movement is isolated from other movements when maybe it doesn't have to. The problem looks very big and very overwhelming, and it's not clear what ordinary people can do to make a difference. And I would submit, when you take old, scary problems and look at it from a new light, and MMT, I think, is a really good light, the problems, the solutions, the possibilities, and the hopes may, in fact, look a lot different. Thank you. And this is my favorite cartoon. If you can't read it, there's a dog on the high wire, and he says, High above the hushed crowd, Rex tried to remain focused. Still, he couldn't shake one nagging thought. He was an old dog, and this was a new trick. So most of the other work groups have been more interactive, and I kind of would have liked to have done that. The disadvantage I was at is most people didn't know what any of this was or what the possibilities were, so I had to kind of start to do it like this. But there is now a national center where they want to coordinate community efforts to get this word out. And it again comes down to people wanting to host talks, get talks, help people do talks, learn to do talks, city council, I mean, all that kind of stuff. So at a minimum, I would like to know if people would be interested in signing up to do this and be involved in the projects, and if people have ideas or questions or challenges or whatever, so I'll open it up to whatever people want to do. It does. It does. First of all, states can't run deficits. So what you're doing is you're running a large deficit by printing the money. And you know, if you go to the banks, they want interest. And if you can't pay it fast enough, you get into trouble. Like if you borrow money and you had to pay interest while you're going to college, that actually happened to me. And suddenly, it's like five times what I borrowed. I'm like, you know. And thinking back on it, it's like, really? But you have to run the deficit first and then create the economic activity to balance that. And states can't do that. Also, for a number of reasons, to get people to accept that money, it has to be at the federal level. Moreover, if you're going to take on the big banks, which ultimately you're going to do, it all has to be federal. But it has to be at a federal level where you have a sovereign money, which unfortunately is not Europe. You know, they have the euro. So Greece can't print the euro. They have to borrow from the banks at high interest. And the more in trouble they are, the higher the interest rate becomes. Then they pressure them to cut and privatize, which means the economy is shrinking and less able to pay the debts, so they're more risky, so they have to get higher debts, and that's the cycle. But you have to be able to print a large deficit initially and have the power to bring that economic stuff to happen. So all that means is got to be at the federal level. There are currency models done on local and state levels that people are talking about. My guess is by the time you get all that to happen, we're going to be past the 4 years, so it makes more sense, I think, just to go for MMT. Well, so, well, first of all, that everyone gets a job, that you can rebuild infrastructure, build green economy, improve healthcare and pensions. That's the benefit. But you're right, people with those money now pay sales tax and income tax that wouldn't have been paid, and the government doesn't have to pay unemployment or welfare or jail costs, so there's that benefit. But the biggest benefit is a better society. You know, infrastructure, green economy, all that kind of stuff. That's the big thing, and it's free. But when you spend the money and people start building infrastructure, healthcare, green economy, those goods and services are what balance the money. I mean, if a bank makes loans right now and you build a factory, the factory you build, that asset ultimately is what balances the money. So the government's just going to do it directly, only it gets to do things banks won't do, and it doesn't have to get paid back. So if you have 10 years to build something and you get stuck in your interest payments right off the bat, you're in trouble. It's not like that. But also the banks can do it in a nonprofit way and say, let's put social needs first, which means green economy, all things I've talked about. So the benefit is fixing unemployment, healing society, and building the goods and services that we need to survive, including facing climate change. That you'll see sales tax and not have to pay for jails and stuff is nice, but that's not the main focus. Now, your hand was next. Well, did I answer your question?
They only spend their own money. They don't use the British pound. So they have developed their own economy within their own city, and they are like, they started it, and then there are like three more communities in England that are doing it. So they haven't gotten it to the country yet, but they're starting it by doing it within their communities. I don't know how they're doing it.
That's possible here. But I haven't seen it, but I'm betting it's going to be different. What we're talking about is large-scale, full employment, building up infrastructure, building up green economy. You know, you're going to have to print out print into, on the computer, trillions and trillions of dollars to do that, and have the policies to make sure it all happens that way. That's going to be beyond. You can argue that, and you can argue we'll gain awareness from that step. But I would argue we have 4 years to get to the climate change, and there isn't time for that, I don't think. So I think the time is to get people to understand we can do it at the federal level. We already have federal people that know this. And their point is, when they've asked is, yeah, I know it, but if I say it, I'll look like a total fool. So until we know it, they can't do it. And then once we know it, say when the midterms come along, you're MMT, you're not MMT, and that's going to make a big difference. So I think really we need to push for that. I heard a couple of questions and I'm not quite sure what you said, so let me just do the best I can with it. One point, I think if this was 10 years ago, I wouldn't have a lot of hope in this because you'd have to get everybody to want believe MMT makes sense and then go. But I think most people have flat out had it with this system. I think though climate change really puts some limits. We need a policy that's going to call out this model for the rest of the world and begin large-scale green economy. And I think what you're describing, you can imagine things that come out of this later, but we've got 4 years to have a World War II mobilization for green economy. So I think the priority is first and foremost to build that green economy. And once we're further along, there are other things this can grow into. I'm not specifically sure quite what you're asking, but I would say we need the large-scale green economy first and foremost. And that you can pick up all the other benefits in the process, I think, makes that really exciting. But I think that's certainly a big alternative model right there. So here's kind of the deal. We have an austerity model where the banks have loaded us down with debts that can't be paid. So as Michael Hudson says, debts that can't be paid won't be paid. And the question is, how won't they be paid? Either we write them off and go in a new direction, or we let ourselves get bled to death the way, say, Greece is. Obama supported the banks, right? They used MMT to bail out the banks and left all the other debts in place. That bank model has overloaned this country, and when they get paid profits, they reinvest in more debt. We can't take on more debt, so they're now pushing on the rest of the world, which is pushing back, and that's what TPP is about. So you're either going to be on the side of saying, we're going to allow the banks to continue this model and spread around the world, or you have to break and go in a different direction. You can say you're against something, but you have to make a decision where you're on that branch point. And the DNC is deeply wedded to the banks, so is Barack Obama, and so is Hillary Clinton. So when she says she's against TPP, given how passionately unpopular it is, everybody running for office is going to tell you they're against the TPP because it'd be pretty suicidal not to, okay? As Secretary of State, she pushed for this very hard. But the key thing is TPP is not separate from austerity, not separate from countries being bled to pay a debt they shouldn't have had in the first place and can't pay. So either you're going to break the austerity model and go in the MMT model, or you're going to be committed to the austerity model. And if you're committed to the austerity model, and she is, then war with Russia and China is very scary. TPP is inevitable. She wants to tweak it and make some changes, but these things bundle, and they're not independent policy things. So she's 45 times pushed for the Secretary of State. She's called it the gold policy. Now she's running for president. I will point out that when Barack Obama was running for president, he said he was opposed to NAFTA and wanted to replace it with something better. And that something better is the TPP. And I'm sorry, but that's what they do when they're running. It's not just that she got paid money to talk to Goldman Sachs, is what she told them and what loyalty was pledged. I mean, that's the question here. So, but I really want to stress that if you maintain this bank model of we're going to make these payments even though we can't, and therefore we're going to have poverty and we're going to have climate change, and we have to then pose this on the rest of the world because we can't take any more debts on here, the military and the TPP things follow as day follows night, and no matter what rhetoric they say, there's not independence in these policies. You know, you're going to go one way or the other. I don't like George W. Bush, but his line, you're either with us or you're with it, you know, it has some application here. So when the banks failed in very rapid order, $13 trillion were put on a keyboard to bail them out, right? The same $13 trillion, they could have just told the banks, see you later, and spent $13 trillion to go another direction. That happened fast. It could happen fast. I mean, the governments can create that money on the keyboards tomorrow and start these programs. It takes political will. And I think, you know, I went back and was talking about this in Occupy, and I was very depressed because there are two things you needed. You needed people to really want to do this and then just be aware the tool was there, and I think then you mobilize. I didn't think there was enough people this hungry for change, and I was proven wrong by Bernie Sanders. Actually, a big moment for me, Richard Wolff was in town supporting Shama Sawant, and he said, you know, when you talk about socialism, you get red-baited. I mean, we all probably all know that. He said, you know, it's funny because the generation, you remember that slide where worker wages were smashed? The generation that grew up with the student loans and the no jobs and all that, they have had it with this system, right? Like 45% say they favor socialism. Whether they even fully know what that means or not, what it means is they have f***ing had it with this system, and they're open for an alternative. And I think that awareness right now is high. They just don't know there's an option. If people actually realize there was a way, how fast did they bail the banks out? Very quickly. Done. You know, here's the block dance, hire people, take all the windmills and solar panels and just put them out there. You could do it very fast when people know about it and demand it. The problem is there's people that know it, but they can't say because it looks crazy. When it becomes something the public understands, they can type it on their keyboard as fast as you can type. I'm not a very fast typist, Carrie will tell you that, but she could do it, she types very fast. But it can be done very quickly once people realize they want to do this and tell the leaders. There was actually a woman who had a clip on the internet where she was a younger person telling Hillary Clinton, you really don't have my vote, but she said in the end, listen, Hillary, either you lead or you get out of the way. And you know, when we come to that conclusion, like you're either going to do this or we're building and we're going to take over the midterms in the next election with somebody who will. And the point is the population to do that is out there now. I didn't realize it, but they're there. They understand this tool. They understand climate change. I mean, it's like any other movement. I think it could be done. But you can put the money on the keyboard very quickly and get this going pretty darn quickly. You, I know somebody's had a hand. Carrie, can you help me?
Yeah, what is the group that's pushing this nationally? What are you saying about?
Well, let me know if you want, and we can talk. But they're just starting this right now. I'm not quite sure how you pronounce that. But the MMT people, Stephanie Kelton, L. Randall Ray, he earned his PhD working with them, and then they started this program. And what they're out there to do is, the research they're doing basically is what's working, what's not working, how can we help movements around the country. They're just starting off, and you know, we're trying to start a chapter in Seattle, and I want to talk to 350 and all the other environmental groups, hey, let's do this in all the other cities, and do this same thing in other cities, and get people out doing the work. So if anyone wants to be part of that, you can please let me know, because that's exactly what I want to come out of this.
Tying it back to this particular conference, if you look at all of the major, at least the three major Judeo-Christian religions, and I would include Islam in that, debt is at a core of the discussion of our faith. fact that, you know, and if you think about, you know, what the way we should be living our lives, it's really a situation where we shouldn't be in debt to other people. In fact, if you look at, say, Islam and Sharia lending, that particular model really doesn't allow you to put people into debt. And so I think if you're looking at that kind of how you tie the faith community into this model, I think you have to go back to the original teachings of our faith and say, you know, it is not consistent with our faith to have a situation where we organize our economy around debts, which force us to do really bad things, you know, like Michigan, like, you know, austerity, like making people make decisions in terms of, you know, cutting down trees or going into debt. You know, and I think that's the type of thing that's maybe missing from your discussion here, is how do we get back to a situation where we avoid the debt which is burdening our kids, burdening our communities.
Okay.
It's you know, can we live in community if we're constantly in a situation where we're enslaved to debt by somebody else?
So a couple things. I mean, it's a good point. It's hard to get everything in, and I appreciate your comment, though. And it's also against probably all religions to enslave people and do all the other horrible things. Debt actually may not be totally avoidable. Actually, you go way back. They were actually doing something similar to MMT. Because you would create money, create a new enterprise, debts would build up, and about every 10 years, they'd write the debt off. In other words, you use debt to start growth. The question is then, do you just forget about it later, or do you turn into a system where the compound interest outgrows the economy and you pull that in? That was a big starting point in the Roman Empire. But basically what MMT is saying is, we're going to create the debt, you're just not going to pay it back.
Well, it's the same principle as Jubilee, right?
Yes, that's exactly what they were doing. They were using the debt to prime the economy, and then they realized there'd come a point where it's going to be harmful, though. We just said, you know, I mean, look, if I took my son and gave him, okay, I spent this much money for your birth and this much for this, and this is your debt, I mean, it would be a really weird thing to do, but at the end I'm going to say I love you and the debt's gone. It's a stupid booking thing, but I'm just saying, you have to sort of put the money out first. The question is it paid back, or you just say it's a community good and we walk away from it? Yeah, and that's what Jubilee is. And in some ways, MMT is not that different than that, actually. So, but you're right. I mean, it would be, again, I'm just trying to explain this and how we would talk to a religious community, how we talk to a labor community. They're all different ways to do it, and that's exactly what we need to set off nationally. So your point is extremely well taken. I just couldn't get everything into the talk. I hope so.
But what do we do, and what can we do to move it along?
Okay, so what I need to do is talk to people to try and get this going in every city in the country. What we need to do in this city is we need to talk about arranging, teaching people to do slideshows, getting venues, getting city council resolutions, getting events, and going on talking to the various communities and figuring out how to do it and what works and what doesn't work, and so that people in Seattle get this. And, you know, also, if we know other churches, getting the churches to do it and talk to other, and basically we want to connect the dots. So what we want to do locally is what we just discussed, but we also want, if our churches are national, we want to be talking to our friends, we want to do social media, we want to get this happening everywhere. It's just public education and campaign building, right? So I would love people to write down their name, we should maybe get together for a meeting, figure out what people want to do, how they want to do it, and then just roll up our sleeves and get to work. But the fact that there's a national place that's going to help us with questions and what we need to learn and what's working and helping us to put in touch, but, you know, for environmental communities, or for in labor communities, or for religious communities, or for in medical communities, I mean, I didn't talk about it, but, you know, a lot of the healthcare problems we suffered on didn't have to happen. They didn't. There was actually, I mean, if you've got healthcare facilities that are not providing care and patients who need care, if you supply the money and create the service, it actually could have worked. I mean, So it's heartbreaking what we witnessed that never had to happen. And encouraging that so many people have had it with it, that I think there is an opportunity to move in this direction. But the reason I focus on this is because it brings everybody together, it gives everybody benefit. From that experience, we can go in other directions, but the urgent thing, of course, is to deal with social problems and build green economy, like immediately, and set in motion what it's going to take to call austerity off for the rest of the world. One, because it's right. Two, because to get to zero emissions by the target, they have to be doing it as well. And three, they desperately need to put in place the things they're going to need to try and minimize the consequences for their population, and we definitely need to help them. But I think this is a key starting point, if that helps. So there'll be a sign-up sheet, and we'll need to get a meeting, and then we'll just brainstorm. Meanwhile, I'm going to try and talk to people to get this going nationally. Other people will do the same, and we'll just figure it out as we go. Well, I guess the first thing I'm saying is, if we can come to terms with this and end austerity in this country and kind of rein in the banks, one of the things we do is we call off the austerity they're imposing on the rest of the world. The rest of the world is going to have to, no one can prescribe what they need to do, but calling off the austerity and making them aware of, that there are other alternatives that they can do to get their economies going is important. I do think we should help them for so many reasons. But I think you can't do everything today, but I think understanding that we can break austerity and what that means for the rest of the world is a starting point. After that, we can bring in powerful economists to give us a better explanation where you want to go from there. But my focus is this is the first step, and I think it's an important one, and the one that at least I'm focusing on.
Do you mean forgiving
debt
when you say calling off
austerity? That would be part of it, yes. And the reason why people can't call off debt, in other countries we send in force. There's a huge history of killing people and overthrowing governments. And in Europe, there's been assassination threats apparently and campaign contributions. But if the population gets that, the thing that intimidates them is the concern they have to submit or there'll be no future money. And the knowledge that that's not true. And that there's a movement starting to surge up. If the United States did this, you have got to believe everybody around the world is going to be saying, huh. And what goes from there, it's hard to say. But that they can see that, say that, and have the safe space to do that, because we're not going to come out. If we democratize our country and they go in other directions, we're going to say no to what we've seen how many times in other countries? Countries have called off debts and have just been terrorized. But if we change here, I think we can call those dogs off. And we need to.
That's the step that I think we're like, wow, this sounds like a rabbit out of a hat. It's too good to be true. It's money out of nothing.
Right.
It is, but then we have to, if that's the crux of the magical moment, we have to be clear about saying, and that's not creating a debt. So that's that miracle step that just, I think, if I'm going to make that speech,
okay, well, if I need to be clear, I'd like to hear exactly what I would do so I can do that in the future. But money is supposed to be created to cause economic activity to happen. It doesn't have to be for profit, and it doesn't have to direct that activity along the lines that corporations want. That's the way it's gone. But, the notion that we can create money to create economic activity, that's what's happening. The question is, are we going to pick economic activity that's more good for people and that's not going to profit at the banks at the expense of everybody else? Because otherwise we're doing it anyway, so that's not such a mystery. It's just saying the financial system is going to behave as a democratic social system, and that allows funding to other activities that can have different criteria as well. So a lot can go from there. But if I wasn't clear, let me know afterwards what you how it. Geez, the banks are a possibility, I think. And the oil companies may not like that either, just to say that. I think your hand was up, but I'm not positive.
I just want to ask a brief question of clarification. Like him, I thought your presentation was excellent, but I'm still grappling with these new concepts. And so is this the place one would go to find out more?
So I have a series of talks and articles that I'm going to try and get either. So I'm either going to do a working group on MMT here in Lynn's group. I'm already in the TPP working group in 350. And I think on that website, I'm going to put up articles and talks so that people can see it. So for example, Stephanie Kelton has a talk. I think she explains things well. She's Stephanie Kelton. Oh, Stephanie Kelton. It's called Angry Birds. It's a wonderful. So what she's saying is she's a deficit owl calm seas in all directions, not these angry birds, we got to pay the debt, we got to pay the debt. It's like, slow this down. So she's got, so anyway, interact with me. If you send me a Facebook friend request, I have everything on my Facebook thing, and I can just send it to you. So, I mean, I can do it that way. I do want to get a web page either, and Liz's group, or in the 350 group I'm in. That's a TPP group, but we're going to carve out an MMT space. So I think we're going to be in both groups. But I am the worst web page person in the world. My son has to do that for me. But we'll post it, I think, on the 350 TPP website, and I will post it once we get a website here, and I have it on my friend book thing. So, so Lynn's forming a new climate action group here. Nope, it's her. So she's starting a new climate organization, and I'm going to lead an MMT work group in her organization on the same time I'm doing MMT TPP work in 350. If we're in email contact with one another, I can send you links, and we're going to create a space somewhere where you can get this information. Oh, just write down your name and email address, and we'll be in. Oh, my name is, so it's Randy Val. I won't tell you my wife's name, you'll just have to guess. RANDYVAL at comcast.net. Randy, all one word. Val Randy was taken. So you can contact me. We're going to get a sign-up sheet. Hopefully we'll get a meeting, and I can bring whatever information you guys need. But if you Google Stephanie Kelton Angry Birds, there's some really good stuff there. And then I should maybe try and put together a link where I can give you the links to some really good talks and then articles. So this work group is just starting. But we can definitely get information for everybody. But I know it sounds too good to be true, but I promise you, it is true. And if nothing else, Bernie Sanders believes it. So if you tend to be sympathetic to Bernie Sanders, he seems to believe it. And we can trust Bernie. Fair enough. Fair enough. Well, that's a lot of them about. I mean, take Nicaragua. Nicaragua basically said they weren't going to pay. The U.S. put debt to Somoza. The key got kicked out, and the country said, "Well, you have to pay that debt." People didn't take that debt on, and basically said, "We're not going to pay the debt anymore. We're going to spend that money on social programs." And the rest of the world said, "I know it's going to happen, because if you can do this, we want to do this too." And of course, we know what the U.S. did. And there's no shortage of examples. And it's not just Latin America. You know, it's Asia, it's the Middle East, it's Africa. And in many ways, it's what you're seeing in the Eurozone right now with the banks imposing the austerity is essentially a coup as well. And at least according to Michael Hudson, you know, important leaders there who were opposing this have their lives threatened by the banks, which, you know, wouldn't exactly be without precedent. So yeah, but you're right. That's the point. If you can get people to understand we need to break this austerity model, hopefully it creates a great deal of space for the rest of the world. And we should remember the debt the third world, it was imposed on purpose. What the United States wanted them to do was have debt payments so high, all the money they made had to go to debt service so they couldn't develop an independent country because we didn't want them to have to compete with us on our markets. So the debt was never consensual, it was never fair, and it doesn't exist. However, there is a debt, and that's the debt that we owe them for what's been done to them. And given how far behind they are with facing with climate change and how the global south is likely to get pounded, you know, we might want to think that we actually need to repay our debt.